Welcome to all of the party, all the participants on the final day of 5 days FDP, Atal FDP on organizational behavior, organized by Department of Management, Mizoram University in association with AICTE, New Delhi, Government of India. And today I feel proud to introduce a very renowned resource person, Dr. P. Karthikeyan from Periyar University. He is an associate professor and head Department of Management, Periyar University. Professor Karthikeyan has a wide experience of delivering lecture, not only in India, but outside the India also. Sir has guided so many scholars and presented a large number of excellent papers in the top management journals. And I am also welcoming sir for always supporting our department. He always support our department. And I am so happy to welcoming Dr. P. Karthikeyan to deliver the lecture in our FDP program. And he was very busy, as he told that online exam and all those things were going on, but still he has given time to us. So we are so thankful, sir, to you and welcome you to start your presentation. Dr. P. Karthikeyan, sir, please, sir.
Thank you so much, sir. Amit Kumar Singh, sir. Thanks for your invitation and introduction and everything. I wholeheartedly thank the team also for considering my name to include as resource person in this 5-day FDP sponsored by AICTE New Delhi for the benefit of the students, community, as well as the faculties too, and who is pursuing academic as well as the research programs in the field of management as well as in the social science and psychology too. Actually, the topic devoted to my is group dynamics. Now, friends, I think the slide pages are visible, and we will touch the essence and the creamy points that is connected to group and group dynamics. This is the agenda of the session, and we will go with that discussion points. Okay, so the first thing we should understand what is group. Of course, many of you people from academia and academicians, and you people are aware of that particular concept, and anyways, the concepts may be refreshed by attending this 5-day online FDP organized by the team headed by Professor Amit Kumar Singh at the Department of Management, Mizoram University, Mizoram. Actually, the team is taking sincere effort in bringing the sponsorship from the AICTE and conducting this 5-day program by inviting various people from various corners of our country with many more topics connected to organizational behavior. And we are very much fortunate enough to have such noble persons in academia. And I am also very much happy to be a part of this particular program as a resource person for the topic group dynamics. So here, what is group? What is group? The first question by default, this particular thing may arise into our mind, that is, a group is a collection of people with some common characteristics or purpose. So this is the thing that is existing in the slide. Okay, so a group is a collection of people. Collection of people means collection of individuals. Collection of individuals with some common characteristics or purpose. Okay, so every individuals, you know, may have different opinions, different ideas, different thoughts, different experience, different, you know, but the ultimate of the group is single purpose. Single purpose. Okay, so I often used to say that when you talk on about this group, okay, we should remember the concept called normality curve, normal distribution curve. So how this normal distribution curve may look like? It may look like this. Okay, so you just keep close all your fingers in your hand, and you may see that okay, it may look like a wave, single wave. It's a bit like a bell shaped. Okay, all five fingers are in different heights. Okay, so if everything is in same height, you know, it never give anything. Okay, it never give anything. All five fingers are in different heights and different size, you know, different weight, everything is there. We should see that in group, okay, this normality curve may exist. Okay, so a group is a collection of individual, that is a collection of people who have relations to one another that make them, okay, interdependent to some significant degree. Yeah, so defined, you know, the term group refers to a class of social entities having in common the property of interdependence among their constituent members. Okay, so this is the simple meaning about a group. We will move to the next. So by referring that meaning, okay, we can enlist a few number of characteristics which is connected to group. Okay, the first one is two or more persons. If you depute only one individual, this never be considered as a group. Okay, the group must two or more persons. This is first one. Okay, first characteristics that we normally think it about group. Okay, second one is synergy. Okay, one advantage of working in group, okay, is that they allow us to accomplish things we would not be able to accomplish on our own. Okay, systems theory suggests that the whole is greater than the sum of its parts. Okay, the whole is greater than the sum of its parts. This is the very idea of synergy that we are going to talk about in this. Okay, in an orchestra or band, each person is there to perform in order to help the larger unit make music in a way that cannot be accomplished without each member working together. Okay, the best example that we can quote, orchestra or band. Okay, third one is a common goal. Having a interaction and a synergy, interaction that we are going to see in this, okay, synergy would be relatively pointless in groups without a common goal. People who comprise groups are brought together for a reason or a purpose. While most members of a group have individual goals, a group is largely defined by the common goals of the group. Your common goal in a classroom is to learn, complete an assignment, and earn a grade. Okay, so what final grade is acceptable, for example, or how to achieve the common goals? The group is largely defined by the common goals it shares. Okay, fourth one is phase to phase. Is if you join in a group, you must have face to face contact with other members, people exist in that group. Okay, for any reasons, you may share, you may communicate, you may deliver, you may get it. Okay, for any reasons, you should have some face to face contact with the members who exist in that group. Next characteristic is interdependence. Groups cannot be defined simply as three or more people talking to each other or meeting together. Instead, a primary characteristic of groups is that the members of a group are dependent on one another for the group to maintain its existence and achieve its goals. In essence, interdependence is the recognition by those in a group for their need for the others in the group. Okay, so interaction, if probably seems obvious to you that there must be interaction for groups to exist. You must have interaction with the people who is existing that group, that is vital. However, what kind of interaction must exist? Because we all communicate every day. There must be something that distinguishes the interaction in groups from other forms of communication. Okay, usually in formal groups, okay, let me discuss about formal group and informal group in the forthcoming slide pages. Okay, so for they go on to break down purposeful interaction into four types. Okay, maybe problem solving, role playing, team building, and trust building. Maybe without purposeful interaction, a true group does not exist. Roles, norms, and relationships between members are created through interaction. If you are put into a group for a class assignment, for example, your first interaction probably centers around exchanging contact information, settings of times to meet, and starting to focus on the task at hand. It's purposeful interaction in order to achieve a goal. The ultimate of having this group is to achieve the organization goal. Okay. So next characteristics is shared norms. Because people come together for a specific purpose, they develop shared norms to help them achieve their goals, even with a goal in place. Okay, a random interaction does not define a group. Okay, group interaction is generally guided by norms. Okay, a group has established for acceptable behavior. Norms are essentially expectations of the group members established by the group and can be conscious and formal, or unconscious and informal. A couple of examples of group norms include the expectation that all members show up at group meeting times, the expectations that all group members focus on the group instead of personal matters, and the expectations that group members finish their part of the work by the established due date. When members of the group violate group norms, other members of the group get frustrated and the group's overall goal may be affected. Okay, so the last characteristics in this list is cohesiveness. One way that members understand the idea of communicating in groups and is when they experience a sense of cohesiveness with other members of the group. When we feel like we are part of something larger, we experience a sense of cohesion or wholeness and may find a purpose that is bigger than our individual desires and goals. It is the sense of connection and the participation that characterizes the interaction in a group as different from the defined interaction among loosely connected individuals. If you have ever participated in a group that achieved its goal successfully, you are probably able to reflect back on your feelings of connections with the other members of that group. So we can refresh the characteristics, okay, all these while referring the meaning that we had in the previous slide. The next is types of groups. Types of groups. So we have six types. Normally we may brought into the light, that is formal groups, informal groups, command groups, task groups, interest groups, and the friendship groups. Let us see one by one. Okay, formal groups. Formal groups are created to achieve specific organizational objectives. Usually they are connected with the coordination of work activities. People are brought together based on different roles within the structure of the organization. The nature of the task to be undertaken is a predominant feature of the formal groups. Informal groups, within the formal structure of the organization, there will always be an informal structure. The formal structure of the organization and the system of role relationship, rule and procedures will be augmented by interpretation and development at the informal level. Informal groups are based most or more on personal relationships and agreement of groups members than on defined role relationships. They serve to satisfy psychological and social needs not related necessarily to the tasks to be undertaken. Groups may devise ways of attempting to satisfy members' affiliations and other social motivations that are lacking in the work situations, especially in individuals working in an industrial organizations. Third, common groups. This is a formal group. Command group is a formal group determined by the organization's hierarchical chart and composed of the individuals that report to a particular manager. Say, for instance, the manager of training as a command group of his employees, the training group. Task groups. This is also a type of formal group. Task groups is also a type of formal group, and the term is used to describe those groups that have been brought together to complete a task. This does not mean though that it's just a group of people reporting to a single supervisor. The training group used in the last example, what we discussed, no? Is not the same as the task group that provides onboarding training for a new employees newly recruited into that organization. The training department might provide the outline for how a new employee is brought into the company, but an onboarding task group would include that employee's manager, an IT manager maybe, who equips the new employee with gadgets like computer, phone, and so on. Next is interest groups. An interest group is usually informal and is a group of people who band together to attain a specific objective with which each member is concerned. Within an organization, this might be a group of people who come together to demand better working conditions or a better employee evaluation process. Outside of an organization, okay, this term is frequently used in normally in political situations to describe groups that give a point of view, a voice. The last one is friendship groups. These are groups of people who have come together because they share common ideas, okay, common interests, or other similarities like age or ethnic background and so on. Okay. So let us try to differentiate these two normally used groups in an organization, that is formal group and the informal group. So the first difference exists based on meaning. Okay, so you know that a formal group created by the organization to accomplish a specific task. Okay, whereas the informal group, you know, created by the employees itself, okay, employees itself or themselves for their own sake. Okay, for their own sake. The second criteria for our differentiation is formation basis. You know, this formal group is framed deliberately by the organization authorities, whereas the next is framed voluntarily by the employees working in that organization. Normally you take the size of a formal group is large and the informal group may be comparatively small. You know, the lifetime of the formal group is depends on the type of group, and whereas in case of informal group, it depends on the members. Structure, you know, in formal group it is well defined. Okay, it covers rules, regulations, policies, so you know everything. But in this non-informal group, there is no defined structure. Okay. Then the importance is given to position in case of formal group, whereas in case of informal group, the importance is given to person. Okay, so the relationship, you know, in informal formal group, it is a professional relationship that may exist among the members involved in that group, whereas in informal group, you know, it is a personal relationship. Okay, so based on communication, formal group moves in a defined direction. Okay, so the second one, that informal group, okay, stretches in all the directions. Okay, today this may go to the north and next day it may go to the east. There is no defined direction that may exist in informal group. Okay. So further, you know, defined the direction in the sense vertical, horizontal, you know, upward, downward, like that. Whereas all the direction in the sense grapevine type of communication may be adopted by the group members in informal. Okay. So let us refer the definition. Contributed by the Lecart. Okay, the greater the loyalty of a group toward the group, the greater is the motivation among the members to achieve the goals of the group, and the greater the probability that the group will achieve its goal. Okay, means group dynamics can be used as a means for problem solving, teamwork, and to become more innovative and productive as an organization as whole. This concept will provide you with the strengths, success factors, and measures of group dynamics along with the other professional tools. So it is a set of, it is means group dynamics is a set of behavioral and psychological processes that occur within a social group or between groups. It refers to the nature of groups, the laws of their development, and their interrelations with individuals, other groups, and larger institutions. So by keeping that definition contributed by the Likert for group dynamics, and the following principles may be enlisted for the same concept called group dynamics. The first principle is perception. Principle of perception. Perception, we can say in simple term, that is level of understanding. Okay, level of understanding may differ from one individual to another individual. Communication may be same. Communication media may be same. Communication content may be same. The person who is communicating may be same, but the level of understanding, you know, that may differ from one individual to another individual who is there in that group. So this principle focuses on the prestige of group members and how the group members perceive this prestige. It is very similar to the principle of status that we are going to see, that we are principle of status. However, this principle of group dynamic states that the greater the prestige, the greater is the influence. In addition, the principle of perception throws light on the importance of group perception. Moreover, this ensures coordination, a common direction, and the successful completion of the objectives. Second is principle of belongingness. An essential group dynamic is for the group members to have a strong essence of togetherness. Moreover, a group will not be able to function, okay, to its fullest without the coordination and the belongingness that the members feel. It is very important for the group members to feel like they belong to the right group. In addition, the principle of perception throws light on the importance of group perception. Okay. Moreover, this ensures coordination, okay, and everything. Then the next one is the principle of change. The principle of change is one such important principles of group dynamics that state the significance of the change. Change is the constant. Okay, in an organization, normally people do accept the changes. If people do not accept or deny the changes, you know, they will be removed from the market. That is the condition exist. Every good morning, okay, should start with some changes. Every decision in a group is bound to change at a specific point in time. A well-balanced and coordinated group would not suffer from this change. Moreover, this group dynamic principle stresses the importance of handling a change well. The next principle is principle of conformity. The principle of conformity states the importance of group members to conform to the general group norms. However, this principle is one of the most essential rules, which is the most difficult to achieve. Okay, then principle of power. Being a part of a group can let a group member believe that they have powers vested in them. One of the most and more critical principles of group dynamics is the existence of power among the group members. Next, common motives principle. Principle of common motives. The main purpose behind the creation of groups, group A, is to aid the process of goal achievement of the organization. The group members have a common motive, which involves the successful attainment of the predetermined goal of an organization. The next principle is principle of readjustment. Okay, whenever you find changes in your organization, this principle start functioning. This principle is a result of the principle of change. Due to changes made in a group, the group norms, the group objectives, or the group members' delegation, readjustment of the entire group dynamics is crucial. Therefore, this principle of readjustment emphasizes on the essentiality of readjusting the group dynamics after implementing a change. The readjustment should be in sync with the adjustment or achievement of the group goal of an organization. The next principle is continuous process principle. Group functioning is a continuous process. This principle states that every group so formed and every member who is a part of such a group is responsible for everything, responsible for the continuous functioning of the same group. Groups adjourn only upon the completion of the task or the achievement of the goal. Until then, the principle of continuous process is widely applied to group dynamics. Then, goal orientation principle. So, every group is created with the aim to achieve the goal with the help of their common motive. The primary principle of the group is that they are goal oriented and focus on their activities towards the successful completion of the task. So these are all the principles of group dynamics, and let us discuss how the healthy group climate may be created. So healthy group climate creation may help the organization to have a dynamic groups, so that the group dynamic will be exist. The first one is openness. Openness. Group members are willing to get to know one another, particularly those with different interests and backgrounds. They are open to new ideas, diverse viewpoints, and the variety of individuals present within the group. They listen to others and elicit their ideas. They know how to balance the need for cohesion within a group with the need for individual expression. The second one is trust and self-disclosure. Group members trust one another enough to share their ideas and feelings. A sense of mutual trust develops only to the extent that everyone is willing to self-disclose and be honest, yet respectful. Trust also grows as a group. The members demonstrate personal accountability, for the tasks they have been assigned. Third one is support. Group members demonstrate support for one another as they accomplish their goals. They exemplify a sense of team loyalty, and both cheer on the group as a whole and help members who are experiencing difficulties. They view one another not as competitors, which is common within a typically individualistic educational system, but as collaborators. Next is respect. Now, group members communicate their opinions in a way that respects others, focusing on what can be learned rather than who is to blame. That is most important. Individual responsibility and accountability. All group members agree on what needs to be done and by whom. Each member determines what he or she needs to do and tasks responsibilities to complete their tasks. they can be hold accountable for their tasks, and they hold others accountable for their. Okay, constructive feedback. You know, group members can give and receive feedback about the group ideas. Giving constructive feedback requires focusing on ideas and behaviors, you know, instead of individuals. Being as positive as possible, right? And offering suggestions for improvement. Receiving feedback requires listening well, you know, asking for clarification if the comment is unclear, and being open to change and other ideas. Okay, so if we adopt all these 6 points, we can establish, you know, a healthy group climate that in turn will create a better group dynamics. So the biggest challenge in an organization is getting people work together. We can align all the machines together. We can ask the machine just by pressing a single button, and it will run its activities without making any discussion with any machines. It will perform its performance, okay, better, but human beings or not. Okay, so work together is something. So reasons for joining group is another one important thing that we should. That is about the 6 reasons that we may enlist in normal course. The first one is security. Okay, so probably the strongest reason for group formation is the people need for security. People need for security. By joining a group, we can reduce our insecurity. We feel stronger, have fewer self-doubts, and are more resistant to threats. Okay. Second is esteem. An individual can increase his self-esteem through group member. Through group member or group members, first one may gain esteem by becoming a member of a high status group. Esteem, no? A high status group. Associating with the high status people is reinforcing. Again, and one who belongs to such a group is usually accorded a high status by outsiders. Second, the close relationship an individual can develop as a group member provides opportunities for recognition and praise that are not available outside of the group. Third is affiliation. Another reason why people join group or groups is that they enjoy the regular company of other people, you know, particularly those who possesses common interests. Individuals may seek out others at work who shares common hobbies and common backgrounds. Fourth reason is power. Membership of groups offers power to members in at least 2 ways. The first one is, there are sayings such as "United we stand." United we stand. "Divided we fall." United we stand. Divided we fall. Okay, but that is unionist. Union is strength, and there is strength in members. Okay, these are driving forces behind unionization. Okay, workers enjoy much greater power collectively than they do as individuals. The second is the leadership of an informal group enables an individual to exercise power over group members, even if he does not enjoy the formal position of authority in the organization. The fifth reason is identity. You know, group membership contributes to the individual's eternal quest for an answer to the question, "Who am I?" It is common knowledge that tries to understand ourselves through the behavior of others towards us. If others praise us, we feel we are great. If others enjoy our jokes, we see ourselves as funny persons, okay, and so on. Groups provide several others who will love, praise, and admire us. Sixth and the last one is huddling. One more reason why individuals want to join groups is for huddling. Because of the way individuals, particularly executives, make use of informal get-togethers called huddles. Okay, they are intimate, task-oriented encounters of executives trying to get something done. Okay, huddling enables executives to deal with emerging matters and minimize the amount of surprise. Okay, it also reduces red tabs by cutting hierarchical channels of communication and minimizing misunderstandings. Because organization charts represent real duties, huddling can compensate for a lack of leadership by taking collective and unofficial responsibility for getting things done, right? So you can also include many more number of reasons in addition to the list that we discussed so far. Then, why are groups framed? The five reasons are exchange of ideas. Members involved in that group, they can exchange their ideas with one to another, so that the ideas may be refined and the goal may be achieved within a short span of time. That is the vital. Second is create awareness. One person may have an awareness of one particular task or job, and some of them may not have that kind of that much amount of experience or literacy on the job which is to be carried out by that organization. So that a senior person may be deputed as the leader of that particular group, and members of the group may get trained initially, and the work may be carried out then later, so that the people involved in that group may get some awareness on the work to be done by that organization. Third one is for development purposes. Okay, so individuals can do perform can achieve to that level, but collective possible. Okay, you can frame the group, and this is for the development purposes. Okay, the fourth one is collective achievements. For collective achievements, okay, very simple thing, I need not explain on this. So then fifth one is into welfare of members. Okay, one person may have idea, one person may not have an idea. Okay, so people having experience may support the people work may be carried out within a period of time. So next we may discuss about the five stage model of group. Okay, which is developed by Bruce Duckman in the year 1965. for the purpose of group formation. Okay, so the thing is, psychologist Duckman first came up with the memorable phrase, that is, only four things: forming, storming, norming, and performing, in the year 1965 in his article titled "Developmental Sequence in Small Groups." He used it to describe the path that most teams follow on their way to high performance. Later, he added a fifth stage too, okay, a journey, okay, which is sometimes known as mourning, okay, that is MOURING, mourning. So let's look at each stage, okay, with little detail. Okay, the first stage is forming. Okay, members get to know each other and set ground rules. So in this stage, most team members are positive and polite. Some are obsequious, okay, as they haven't fully understood what the team will do. Okay, others are simply excited about the task ahead. As leader, you play, okay, you may be a leader, okay, in your group, you play a dominant role at this stage because team members' roles and responsibilities are not clear. This stage can last for some time as people start to work together as they make an effort to get to know their new challenges or new colleagues, okay, in the team. Then stage two, storming. Members come to resist control by group leaders and so hostility. That is, the team moves into the storming phase, okay, where people start to push against the boundaries established in the forming stage. This is the stage where many teams fail. Many teams fail. The storming often starts where there is a conflict between team members' natural, okay, working styles. Okay, you may have your own natural working style and another one, and your team leader may force you to adopt this particular working style. Okay, that time, you know, people may work in different ways for all sorts of reasons, but if differing working styles cause unforeseen problems, they may become frustrated. Storming can also happen in other situations. Say, for example, team members may challenge your authority or jockey for position as their roles are defined, or if you haven't defined clearly how the team will work, people may feel, okay, overwhelmed by their workload, or they could be uncomfortable, okay, with the approach, okay, you are using. Some may question the worth of their team's goal or group's goal, and they may resist to taking on tasks. Okay, team members who stick with the task at hand may experience stress, particularly as they don't have the support of established processes or strong relationships with their colleagues. Okay, then the stage number three, it is norming. Members work together, developing close relationships, feelings of cohesiveness. Okay, gradually the team moves into the norming stage. This is when people start to resolve their differences. Okay, appreciate colleagues' strengths and respect your authority as a leader. Okay, now that your team members know one another better, they may socialize together and they are able to ask one another for help and provide constructive feedback. People develop a stronger commitment to the team goals. Okay, and you know, here in norming stage, people develop a stronger commitment to the team goal, and you start to see progress. Okay, towards it, there is often a prolonged overlap between storming and norming, because as new tasks come up, the team may lapse back, okay, may go back into behavior from the storming stage. Okay, then stage number 4, it is performing. Group members work towards getting their jobs done. That is, the team reaches their performing stage. When hard work leads without friction to the achievement of the team's goal or group's goal, the structures and the processes that you have set up support this well. As leader, you know, you can delegate much of your work and you can concentrate on developing team members. It feels easy to be part of the team at this stage, and people, you know, who join or leave won't disturb, okay, disturb the performance of the members that the people exist in the group. And the stage number 5, adjourning. Okay, a group may disband either after meeting their goals or because members leave. Okay, so many times we'll reach this stage eventually. Okay, for example, project teams exist for okay, only a fixed period, and even permanent teams may be disbanded through organizational restructuring. Team members who like routine, you know, or who have developed close working relationships with colleagues may find this stage difficult, particularly if their future, you know, now looks uncertain. Okay, so this is the thing that is the model developed by the Bruce Truckman in his article, okay, about half a century back. Okay, this slide page will explain you how the stages are moving and everything. And now we will discuss about the conditions imposed on the group. Actually, when you talk about these conditions, two major factors which affects group performance in an organization, that is external conditions and group structures. In external conditions, we have 5 things that we have to discuss, and in group structure, we have a lengthy list. Okay, a group is a part of large organizations. Okay, it's a part of large organizations. Okay, they are created by the organizations, and as such, they do not exist in isolation. A group has to rather work within the framework provided by the organization. Every group is influenced by a number of external conditions imposed from outside it. Okay, these external conditions include organization strategy, rules and regulations, culture, okay, physical work setting, and you know, employee selection process. Okay, so the next is group structure. It is a group size, group composition, group status, group norms, group roles, conformity, group resources, you know, group process, group performance. Okay, so these factors, okay, normally exist in group structure. Group structure. So when you structureize, when you start structurizing the group, you should remember all these things. Okay, how this the group. First one is group size. So normally a minimum of 2 members, okay, as required to form a group, as far as the maximum number is concerned. Okay, it is up to the requirement of the organization and the group concerned. The group should have as many members as can interact, okay, meaningfully amongst one another. However, an ideal group size is said to comprise of 5 to 7, maximum of 10, you know. Second one is group composition. A group comprises of a number of individuals with varied qualities and characteristics. In fact, most of the group activities require a variety of skill and knowledge. Say, take Indian cricket team. So not all cricket team members are bowlers or batsmen. Okay, some of them specialized in batting, some of them specialized in bowling, some of them specialized in wicket keeping, you know, some of them specialized in all rounding performance, you know. As far as group composition is concerned, a group may be homogeneous, heterogeneous. Okay, heterogeneous groups on the other hand are the ones which comprise of dissimilar individuals. Okay, so this is just opposite to the previous class of group, homogeneous group, you know. Personality may be different, age may be different, gender may be different, experience and knowledge and other aspects also may vary from one individual to another individual who is there in that group. So we should identify the need. Okay, then group status. The term status refers to the relative ranking that a person holds in a group. Status is determined in the context of comparison. Okay, therefore status defines the rank of an individual relative to others. Okay, so status is in fact defines in terms of rights, duties and obligations the individual holds in an organization. Okay, so leader of the group may have something and the members exist in that group may have something. Okay, group norms are the norms means it should be okay of behavior. They are prescriptions. Norms are prescriptions for acceptable behavior determined by the group. Group norms, okay, are a set of beliefs, feelings and attitudes commonly shared by group members. These are also referred to as rules or standards of behavior that apply to group members exist in a established group or the group which is to be established. Then group roles, you know, all members of group, you know, are expected to play specific roles. By this term, we mean a set of expected behavior patterns attributed to someone, okay, occupying a given position in a social unit. Quite often this role is a function of the individual's job description. Okay, a role consists of a pattern of norms. It is a position that can be acted out by an individual. Okay, a role can best be defined as a position that has expectations evolving from established norms. Okay, so the conformity. Okay, so conformity means adjusting one's behavior to align with the norms of the group. There is considerable evidence that groups can place strong pressures on individuals to change their attitudes and behaviors to conform to sometimes people belong to many groups, you know, at the same time, and their norms vary in some cases. Okay, there may be even extraordinary norms. Then group resources. By the term group resources, we mean the resources that an individual members brings the group. So the group performance to a large extent depends upon the resources of its members, that is knowledge, skills, efficiency, capabilities, you know, personality characteristics. All are the resources that may be brought to the group by the individuals exist in that group. Then group process. Another component in our group performance model, you know, is the group process. A group process can be simply defined as a systematic method of handling activities. Okay, so the method established will support the organization to carry out the process, or the task is defined already. A process can be simply defined as a systematic method of handling activities. You know, again, some of these processes that affect group performance include the communication patterns, leader behavior, group decision making, inter-group behavior, group cohesiveness, etc. The group processes may have a positive or at times even a negative impact on the group performance. Okay, group performance is the last one. Group performance is contingent upon a number of factors. For instance, the external conditions, which include the rules, regulations, selection procedure of the organization, etc., highly affect the group's performance. Similarly, the group is more likely to be protective when its members have requisite skills, personality characteristics, etc. Okay, so this is the thing that group behavior model, that the performance and the satisfaction of a group and members is based on the group task, and the group task is it is an intervening variable, and the group processes is one of the deciding variable which influence the performance and the satisfaction of the group. And the group member resources, which already discussed in the previous case, group resources, then the group structure will influence the group processes. These are all the things that I decided to discuss it on. So the next is group structure, that is cohesiveness. Again, cohesiveness, it is a degree to which group members are attracted to each other and are motivated to stay in the group. That is most important. That group that is decided by some factors. So make the group smaller first. If you expand the numbers, then there is a chance of having a miscommunication, then misrepresentation, conflict, etc. Encourage agreement with group goals. Increase time members spend together. Increase group status and admission difficulty. Then stimulate competition with other groups. You may establish some number of groups in an organization. okay, that groups may perform the similar activities. Say, for example, marketing department may establish different groups. Okay, one group may function in north, okay, north zone. Another group may function in south zone. Okay, likewise, different zones may be created. Okay, each zone may consist of different groups. Okay, so you may stimulate competition among them, okay, with other groups to enhance the performance of marketing team. Okay, this is the best example that I want to share in this forum. Give rewards to the group, okay, not individuals. Don't recognize the individuals in the group, but you may praise them, but you please give the reward to the group. Okay, say for example, you take again cricket. Okay, now the IPL trophy is in pipeline and the matches are going on in Gulf, you know, so the final cup may be given to the team, not to the individual. Okay, so physically isolate the group. Okay, so individuality of the group may be proven, okay, by doing this. So the next is group decision making. When the group decision making may be done by group think and group shift. Okay, so phenomenon in which the norm for consensus overrides the realistic appraisal of alternative course of action may support you to do this. Group shift, a change, okay, in decision risk between the group decision, okay, group's decision and the individual decision that members within the group would make, can be either reward, okay, can be either toward conservatism or greater risk. Okay, so these are all the techniques that you can use for the purpose of group decision making for your better group dynamics, you know, interacting groups. Okay, so the first one is interacting groups. You, that is the typical groups in which members interact with each other face to face. Okay, brainstorming is another one technique, and idea generation process. It is an idea generation process that specifically encourages any and all alternatives while withholding any criticism of these alternatives. Okay, third one is normal group techniques. Normal group techniques, that is a group decision making method in which individual members meet face to face to pool their judgments in a systematic but independent fashion. Okay, fourth one is electronic meeting. Okay, a meeting in which members interact on using gadgets, you know, like computers, smartphones, allowing for anatomy of comments and aggregation of words. Okay, so let me discuss the various roles played by group members. Okay, there are three things, that is task oriented roles, relations oriented roles, and the third one is self oriented roles. In task oriented roles, we have four things. One is initiators, okay, that is second one is information seekers, third opinion givers, and energizers. Okay, I don't know, the time is available to discuss all the things so elaborately. Okay, then relationship oriented roles are harmonizers, okay, compromisers, encouragers, okay, expediters. In self oriented roles, blockers, okay, recognition seekers, okay, dominators, then avoiders. Okay, so these are all the roles commonly played by the members available in a group that especially constituted by an organization. So let us see some of the proverb, you know, proverb and the Thirukkural, you know, that we normally use in our management studies. Okay, proverbs are used by our MCNs in our nativity, and the Thirukkural, you know, written by saint poet Thiruvalluvar. The first proverb is "Koodi vaazhndhaal koodi nanmai." I spelled this in Tamil. Okay, that is That is, if you join together, okay, if you mingle with people, you can gain more number of benefits, crores of benefits you can enjoy if you are in the crowd, if you are in the group, okay. All right. Second proverb is oru kai thattinal osai elupuma. That is, okay, it is highly impossible to raise voice using single hand. If you use both the hands, you can raise sound. Okay, so that is the thing. That is, be in group, okay, mingle with group, adjust with the group members, okay. So go ahead with the group norms and everything. That is the thing that our ancient people, in that ancient era people used. Ondrupattal unduval. This is another one Tamil proverb. That is, okay, unity stands, okay, unity withstands, okay, unity gives longer life, unity gives longer life. Okay, so unity is strength. It is this is one of the principles, okay, among 14 numbers. Out of 14, this is one of the principles. So Ayyan Thiruvalluvar, you know, our saint poet, you know, says, you know, we discussed that four stage model, then he moved to fifth stage, you know, forming, storming, norming and performing. These things, you know, clearly given by the Thiruvalluvar in his writings, Thirukkural, okay. The team's high performance is achieved by only these four, that is forming, that is coming together. Second one is storming, that is expressing opinions of individuals, okay, giving room to the individuals to reveal their opinions, okay, in the groups. You know, third one is norming, working out the rules and regulations, okay, to enhance the performance of the team, and the performing, getting the job done. Okay, these four things are clearly given by the Valluvar, okay, in his writing. That is, okay, in his 462nd Thirukkural, yeah, தெரிந்த இனத்தோடு தேர்தெணி செய்வார்க்கு அரும்பொருள் யாதொன்றும் இல். Means there is nothing too difficult to be attained by those who before they act, reflect well themselves and thoroughly consider the matter with the chosen friends. Okay, that is, okay. The second is in his 449th Kural, he used, okay, mudalila oodiyam illai madalanai sarbilar killai nilai. That is, there can be no gain to those who have no capital, and in like a manner there can be no performance to those who are without the support of adherents. So means the team member support, you know, is vital. It is equivalent to the capital. Okay. Third one is in his 770th Kural, you know, nilai makkal saala udaithaninum thanai thalai makkal ilvali el. Means, though an army man contain a large number of best soldiers, he cannot loss if it has no good general. Okay, means leader. General means leader. Okay, in an army, a leader should be the deciding authority. He may be the deciding authority. Okay, so do what I say rule, maybe autocratic style may be adopted in that case, and maybe, okay. So the performance of the soldier is on the hands of the general, means good leader in the battle war. Okay, so in my part, I think it is over. I think I completed the session within the time stipulated by the professor Amit Kumar Singh. I think I have not rushed the PPT pages, and I tried my best to feed the material content to the participants who is in this platform to enhance their knowledge towards the topic devoted to. For me, in this session, in 5-day online faculty development program organized by you, by getting the financial support by from the ICTE at New Delhi. Thank you so much, sir, for your invitation and thing went well. I think.
Yes, sir.
Please, the, thank the you. Time is yours. Yes, time sir. Is yours.
Thank you so much, sir, for your very encouraging and exciting lecture. And most of the participants are appreciating and very happy with your lecture. We can take, time is about to finish, but we can take only 2-3 comments from the participants, sir.
Please, sir.
Yes, participants can give comments, but only 2-3 comments we can take up.
Good morning, sir. Can I say something?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, the session was really nice with the team spirit. And small things which sir has highlighted was quite informative. Means he related the concepts with the from the theoretical with the practical notes what we do. So it's really appreciable. And one request to you, sir, please the assignment what we are submitting, we are not getting a response in our mail. So how do we get the acknowledgement? So please kindly confirm it.
The reason for not.
Yes.
Doing that is.
Just बोलता हूँ. Ma'am, time we had given till tonight, and those who are giving the their test, the responses we will give. So since today 4 o'clock we are so busy, we will reply all the responses, and don't worry about that. Individual feedback you will get. And if any problem will come, so and those who are very much regular, those whose attendance is 80% and more, even if any problem is coming in test, we can conduct the retest. We can ask the feedback, and my WhatsApp number is also there. So don't worry about that, ma'am.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. Any other feedback? Yes. Yes, Dr. Sanjay Kumar is willing to say something. Please unmute and tell. Dr. Sanjay Kumar Yadav.
Yes. Yes. Good morning, sir. Yes. Very nice session, sir. I give you much more thanks and appreciate for these group dynamics. Actually, in any organization, we come. In a combined way, and if we trust on each other, definitely we do the best, and we give the best to the organization. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr.
This
Sanjay.
Is what organization requires.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, yeah.
The best example is Professor Tim. You know, doing good, and during this pandemic, sir. Approaching ICT and getting all the people, collectively into a platform and bringing all the participants into this platform through online. And, this is the best example for group dynamics.
Yes.
Professor is best example for group dynamics.
Yes, yes. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, one more comment we can take up because time is already gone. And we have to start the new session at 12 noon. One more comment we can take up.
Hello, sir.
Yes, sir.
Good afternoon, sir. This is Dr. Jeevan Chandra. Sir, your lecture is very wonderful, and you have enlightened us to optimize the group dynamics and achieve our goals in a normative way. Because ultimate thing is to achieve the goals. So the friendship and the optimization between the individuals at various level is essential for the sake of organization as well as the person too. Thank you very much, sir, for enlightened lecture.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Professor Jeevan. Yeah, thank you, sir, once again to all of you. And here I would like to wind up for this session. We are thankful to Dr. Karthikeyan sir, and I am highly thankful to all our participants for their patience listening and interacting with the resource person. And again, we will join the session at 12 noon. And Professor Monica Prakash, who is the officer in charge of the IITTM Noida, she will deliver her speech. So thank you to all of you. We will come again. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your invitation, and thank you once again. We will meet in next opportunity, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes,
sir. Be safe. Amit Kumar Singh, sir, team, and the participants.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you, sir.